Good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the seventh meeting of the Standards, Procedure and Public Appointments Committee in 2024. We've received no apologies this morning. Our first agenda item is for the committee to agree whether to take items 3 and 4 in private. Agenda item 3 will be consideration of the evidence that we are about to hear in public session. And agenda item 4 is to consider our approach to a report from the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body. Are members happy to take those in private? I'm grateful. Our second agenda item is to take evidence under the Scottish Elections Representation and Reform Bill. And we are joined this morning by Malcolm Burr, convener of the Electoral Management Board for Scotland and the Electoral Management Board, Andy Hunter, who's chair of the AEA Scotland and Northern Ireland branch, that's the Association of Elected Administrators, and Robert Nicol, who's vice chair SAA Electoral Registration Committee and ERO for East Renfrewshire, Inverclyde and Renfrewshire Scottish Assessors Association. Very long titles, but you are all very welcome this morning for your contribution towards this matter. And if you're content, I just really want to push off with questions and the usual convener's proviso. Not everybody has to answer all of the questions, but feel free to do so if there's something that you want to contribute. I'd like to kick off with a proposal that is in the bill about extending candidacy rights, in particular to those with limited leave to remain. Malcolm, if I come to you first, what are your thoughts on this? Advantages, disadvantages, or possible concerns that you have?
Extension of candidacy rights, convener, and thank you for the opportunity to give evidence today is, of course, a policy matter, but there are a number of practical issues. I suppose that the main one is that if candidates are allowed to stand for election who may not have the right to remain for the full term of office, there's a potential there for by-elections, which are arguably unnecessary and are certainly costly. So it may be that the bill could be amended to restrict candidacies to those who have leave to remain for the full term of office. One could argue it's a legitimate expectation of the electorate that, except in exceptional circumstances, candidates will be able to serve the full term of office. So those are the only observations I think we would make. I'm straying into the policy remit, I admit, but these are practical consequences of that extension. Otherwise, it's a policy matter, I think. Yeah,
thank you, and absolutely respect the policy element as compared to the implementation. And you talked there about one possible amendment would be where individuals had the limited leave to remain for the full period of proposed office. Do you think, or are you able to comment about whether or not that's a practical solution, given that those who are issued with limited leave to remain are sometimes issued that over varying periods of time? And certainly there is no consideration of electoral office cycles in that discussion.
No, there's no practical solution to that, really, unless the extension is for the full term of office. The candidate, of course, could be asked to declare whether they're qualified or not qualified then to stand for election.
To stand for it. Robert, Andy, is there anything that you want to add to that? Just
That's not really a matter for the ERO.
No, appreciate that.
And add to Mark's comments.
No problem with that. So, it is something that has received significant support in the consultation, and obviously prior to that with the government consultation. So the practical problems rather than the policy decision, you see, if I can put it this way, twofold. Probably the most concerning is a rise in by-elections, which, you know, A, cost money, but B, problematic within the structure. But then the other is in respect of being able to identify whether or not at the time of an election there is likely to be a problem coming down the line with the limited leave either expiring or being rescinded. That's very helpful. I'm going to hand you, throw you to the mercy of the committee. Are there any matters on that before I come to it? If I come to Stephen first, and then I'll come to you, Ivan, and you carry on with the next block.
The respondents to the consultation, 77% of them disagreed with the proposals as individuals with extended candidacy rights. What I'd like to ask Malcolm is, in your experience, are there any other jurisdictions where this sort of extension of candidacy rights exists? What has been their experience, if you'd be willing to share?
I haven't looked into the matter, I regret to say. Since it's a policy matter and therefore not, strictly speaking, within the remit of the EMB, but I'm not aware, of other jurisdictions with such an extensive potential candidacy.
And on the issue of the declaration a candidate makes on presenting themselves as a candidate, they wouldn't currently have to say, this wouldn't be part of the test, as it were, that they were qualified. So it would be a matter of self-identifying as someone who is in the United Kingdom on a limited leave to remain. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct. And of course, it's not for the returning officer to investigate the claims that are made on a nomination form. If it is competent at face value, then we accept it.
So it's possible that someone could present themselves, not identify themselves as someone that's in the United Kingdom on a limited leave to remain, and then during the course of their term of office, they could effectively be asked to leave the country.
Yes, that's possible.
Yeah.
Stephen. Ivan.
Thanks very much. I mean, clearly there are many situations where someone could be elected to serve a term and then not complete that term, some of which may be known to them at the start of the term and others may not be known to them until later through the term itself. But on this specific, you mentioned the fact that the public would perhaps be expected to have a right that if they elect someone, they expect them to, at least at the outset, intend to serve the full term. Is there or would there be provision under the proposals or could there be for such candidates to make it known in the public domain so that the public vote in the full knowledge that there is the potential risk that they may not be able to serve the full term?
Yes, I think that would be possible through the nomination process. There could be a question asked if do you have leave to remain for the entire term? If no, state for how long. That would be possible.
And that would be in the public domain?
That would be so.
In the public domain?
Yes.
OK, thank you.
Thanks.
Moving on to other subjects. There's provision in the proposed bill for Scottish disqualification orders. And I suppose just to start off by getting your perspective on whether intimidation or abuse of electoral workers in Scotland is of itself a problem that needs to be addressed.
Yes, this is just to cover the administrative point first, that would have to be another line in the nomination process, in that the candidate would have to state that they were not disqualified and didn't have a relevant conviction. It's obviously a perfectly competent qualification. I think we would say the nature of intimidatory or abusive behaviour would need to be carefully defined to avoid any, unintended impacts on freedom of political speech. Particularly, I think there's a distinction. I'm verging into my legal territory here. There's a distinction to be drawn perhaps between intimidatory behaviour, which is more objectively assessed, and abusive behaviour, which has a tendency to be subjectively assessed. So those would be my only comments on it. I mean, in terms of process, it's easy enough to manage through the nomination process.
Okay. Have you got any perspective on whether a disqualification order would be likely to act as a deterrent to unacceptable behaviour?
I'm honestly not sure. a lot of certainly abusive comments are off the cuff, are of the moment, and probably wouldn't be caught. One would hope that it would certainly deter anyone with political ambitions who was minded to act in a campaign of intimidation or a premeditated act of intimidation. I'm drawing the distinction here again between intimidatory behaviour and what can be classed as abuse.
Okay. Are there any practical considerations that we'd need to consider? I think you've already mentioned that it would need to be declared potentially up front. Is there anything else? And other members of the panel, feel free to comment if you get any perspective on this.
No, as a returning officer perspective, it would simply be that the candidate would have to state state that they were able to stand. And of course, as always, we would take that at face value. We don't investigate the veracity of these claims.
Okay, and one further aspect on... Sorry, please.
No, just to go back to that, but the disqualification order would be on the public record. So would there be a challenge in an election if there was more onus on those that are checking the details to ensure that that voluntary information is correct? I think it's slightly different from some of the other matters that are rightly taken at face value. If there was a disqualification order in effect, that would be in effect within the public realm. So would it be unreasonable to expect something further than just the candidate themselves having the obligation to propose it?
I have to defend the principle, though, that returning officers do not. I mean, we don't investigate. We don't have that resource, and we don't seek that power. Yes, of course, we use our common sense. If things are known to us, we will raise that matter with the candidate.
Should that be a resource implication, or is it a principle that actually the returning officers should accept what's presented to them by an individual, the supporting team around them?
It's a long-established principle of our electoral practice.
Yeah.
Whether that needs to change in future years is another question, but it's not something we have ever done or needed or really needed to do.
Thank you. Sorry.
No problem. So, and just a final question, and again, don't expect you to take a policy position on this, but just to comment on any practical considerations round about disqualification of candidates, MSPs, councillors that appear on the sex offenders register. Are there any comments you'd like to make on that as an issue?
I think the electoral community and the consultation generally was very much in favour of that disqualification.
Okay. I don't know, Andy or Robert, any comments on any of those issues?
If I can just say, in terms of the electoral registration staff, we're in contact with all members of society throughout the year, and thankfully abuse of our staff is relatively rare. However, we do welcome the inclusion of ERO staff within this definition, because I think it recognises the status of them when they're undertaking their work.
Thanks.
And that itself is an important element of this. Irrespective of the numbers that we're talking about, there should be a recognition of an increased role of respect towards particularly individuals who are seeing the vehicle of democracy being rolled out and brought about.
Yep.
That's helpful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Excellent. Stephen, can I come to you about various changes?
The electoral management work, everything seems to be heading to you, Malcolm. I feel as if there should be a big spotlight coming down on you. Why would it be important that the EMB have a change in its legal status, as is outlined in the bill? What is the reason for that? From your perspective, what are the advantages of that?
Quite a long story there of the evolution of the EMB since its formation as a statutory committee, I suppose, in 2011. Our role has increased. Our the wish for us to support and assist and help in has increased substantially since the EMB was created in 2011. There's two reasons. There's two immediately practical reasons. One is, if we are to perform the role that is now expected of us, for example, to lead the e-counting process, the contractual process, then we need some form of legal status to enable us to enter into contracts, which we can't do at the moment. We're not a legal entity. It's done through a quite convoluted but workable way in which the 32 returning officers give agency to Scottish Government to procure the e-counting contract, and that's managed through a project board of which the EMB plays a key role.
Right.
Does it work
currently?
It worked very well last time, but it would be much easier if the EMB on behalf of returning officers could procure could run that process directly, I think. There are other, the bill proposes some increases in the responsibility of the convener as well. But there's another very practical reason. The Electoral Management Board as an institution is quite a fragile one because it is entirely voluntary activity, and I wouldn't intend that change significantly, but I'm a serving returning officer and chief executive of a council. The secretary, Chris Hycock, is deputy returning officer for Edinburgh and also has duties to that council. We are hosted by and supported by the City of Edinburgh with Scottish Government funding support, which I want to acknowledge. When we've asked for things, that funding has been made available to us. But there is a fragility in that, undoubtedly. It all flows from our roles as returning officers or deputy returning officers, and those are linked to our other jobs. As the workload has increased, particularly over the COVID period, the work on the bill, the coronavirus bill for elections, let's just say there was... The pressures were becoming quite intense. I should say we have tried to mitigate these by the appointment of a deputy convener, and you'll see my comments on that later on. I would like to see two deputy conveners, one on the returning officer side and one on the electoral registration officer side. So there's a practical point about the capacity to contract, and there's a very practical point about the fragility of the current arrangements.
Just talk to us about how the role has expanded. You mentioned since it was founded in 2011.
Yes.
How has it expanded? In what ways has it expanded? And what additional pressures has that created?
I think as the board has become established, there's a representational role on behalf of the electoral community, including such invitations as today's. You're not speaking to returning officers, perhaps from a big council or a small council. You're speaking to me as convener of the board. So there's the representational role. Significantly, the expectations for support from the electoral community have increased. That's partly because of capacity issues. Councils, the corporate services and law and admin departments and councils are not what they were. There is not the in-house experience as well as numbers that there was in the past. So there's a much greater consultative and support role, particularly at the time of elections. The directions which we give in the case of Scottish Parliament and local government elections are necessary. I think they're appreciated and they're negotiated with the electoral community. We don't have anything to do with UK elections, of course, but we do issue recommendations which look very like the directions were it to be a Scottish Parliament election. So I would say rather than...
So has the number of elections and electoral events even though they may be UK-related in terms of general elections and, for example, the EU referendum, membership referendum, that's also created tension. Does that make the last 13 years different than the average period of the work of the board?
It's been exceptionally busy. There's no question about that. We had, of course, two UK elections in a short period. We've had referenda. We don't have European elections now to deal with. But and of course, the other part of the work is not just about elections. It's about accessibility. It's about the focus on the voter. I mean, the strap line we use is, you know, to deliver a result that will be accepted as accurate. I would probably say now be accepted by all reasonable people as accurate, and to focus on the voter. That's what came out of the Gould report way back in 2007, when it was felt the voters' interests had not been properly recognised. So. And the policy interest in elections has grown too. When one thinks of electronic counting, some countries have electronic voting. There's issues about registration. There's a lot more policy interest, I would say, in election matters from both parliaments.
I mean, I've got to say, I've been involved in one or two elections, and I have to say that declaring an interest, convener. I have only ever seen our elections conducted in a very professional and efficient way. So the work, the quality of the electoral experience, speaking as a candidate, has been absolutely first class. But I've got to be clear about that. I've got to declare interest about these things. But I'm also interested in what you said about the voluntary and fragility questions. So for the clarity of those who are watching these proceedings and for the official record, everybody connected with the EMB currently is doing so on the basis, in essence, in a voluntary capacity. There are no paid positions.
We receive a grant from Scottish Government which pays for a certain amount of the time of the secretary, Mr. Highcock, who works for us, works on behalf of the board four days a week on a secondment from City of Edinburgh Council. But that's the only paid.
And the relationship with Edinburgh City Council, you've just kind of described that a little bit more fully. The secretariat, in effect, is sitting within the headcount of the council, and 4/5 of the cost is being paid by the Scottish Government?
Yes, that's correct. That's correct. If, for example, we needed communications assistance or specialist IT assistance or anything of that kind, our first port of call would be City of Edinburgh, because they host us in their offices.
And by and large, that has worked well up until now.
It works well even now. It's simply that it is a very fragile structure because it's heavily dependent on the goodwill of that council. And for all I know, City of Edinburgh may, you know,
kick you out.
May require the services of its own employees in different ways.
Yeah.
I have a very tolerant council about the time I spend on electoral matters, I would have to say. Another council could take a different view. It's simply a little too fragile. I should say that the new arrangements which we would seek, I don't see as being unduly expensive or demanding on the public purse. That we're very conscious.
So the roles would continue to be voluntary. The role of the convener, the role of the so in the bill there's one deputy convener, but
yes,
you've asked for two. Maybe you can explain why you feel there needs to be one, and then why there needs to be two. But these would continue to be voluntary within the jobs, the employment of these individuals in other respects.
I think that will depend on the detail of the constitution of the EMB, which I think needs to be taken forward before the bill advances too much further. I think it's important that members of the EMB, the electoral community, in fact, everyone, you know, is aware of exactly what a new an EMB with legal personality would look like.
Right.
So I think I do think there is a.
So my question's somewhat unresolved then, in the context of the bill, because the bill doesn't describe what you've just said.
No, the bill simply says there will be there a will body be, corporate. Yeah. That requires further work, and that I had a meeting with Scottish Government colleagues yesterday about how we take forward that work, because I think it's important that, and it's extremely important that is clear, and that is known before the bill is, in my opinion, before the bill becomes law.
So, what was agreed yesterday then?
We will look very clearly at the legal options, because body corporate is a generic term. I mean, that can include anything from a company to a partnership to an, obviously these would be inappropriate, but you know, should it be a public body? Should it be an enhanced statutory committee? None of this, I should say, is detrimental to the purpose, and nor I think need it be particularly expensive, but legal status does require a constitution, and it's important, right. and it's important that that is clear. Critical to that, of course, is the independence of the board. That is fundamental. I mean, we're all dependent on someone for funding, of course. And the relationship with Scottish Government colleagues has been very good, very supportive of the EMB. But anybody which advises, supports, delivers elections must have independence, as much independence as possible from the mm-hmm. political process. So that is the other reason that I think it's important the Constitution is agreed at the earliest possible stage.
So what's going to happen then? I mean, because what you've really said, it's very important what you've said this morning, that before this bill can properly proceed through its legislative processes, that we should have a clear understanding of this. So what specific actions are flowing from what you discussed yesterday?
The EMB will work very closely with Scottish Government to, in my opinion, to draft a potential schedule to the bill.
Right.
On which will set out in clear terms how the EMB will be constituted, how it will go about its work, what is its line of accountability, and where is its funding support to come.
And the timetable for the production of the schedule?
That's a priority, I think, for over the next 3 months.
And where does the balance of the work lie, with the EMB or with the Scottish Government?
It's Scottish Government's bill, and of course it's the parliamentary draftsman that will take that work forward. But we will play an active part in that process.
In mindful of time,
I apologise for the length of my.
No. This is precisely why we invite you to give this level of detail and evidence, which is very good. So my final question, reassuring the convener, my final question is around the issue of why we need a deputy convener and why you feel we need two deputy conveners.
I think any organisation with any kind of statutory power should have a deputy. Things happen. The power to give directions is personal to the convener. It's not... The directions are not given by the board, they're given by the convener of the board. So there should be, just for reasons of efficiency, as it were, there should always be a deputy who's able to exercise full powers of the convener in the event of incapacity or worse. I think Scotland has a fairly unique system of returning officers and electoral registration officers now. And the board brings these two professions together, and I think it recognises that the convener, of course, must be a returning officer in terms of the current establishment, and that I think is right. But it is right that the statutory there would be a statutory position, I think, which recognises the electoral registration officer part of the electoral process as well as the returning officer side. So that's that. Hence the recommendation. So but if that is not agreed with, there should at least be one deputy who can act for the convener in the event of incapacity.
From whichever function,
yeah,
that would come from. I think I might have perjured myself because I think I continue. Do I?
No.
I don't continue.
Unless you have anything that follows on.
Not on that section,
that's
no.
Fine. That's fine. Do any other members have questions on that before I move? Please, Jackie.
Just for some clarification. So what you were saying just now about the ERO and the returning officer, are you suggesting that the deputy conveners, there should be one of each to ensure that... All bases are covered, so to speak. Sorry if I'm misheard.
Yes, I am, because that reflects the informal arrangements that we already have in place. I have a deputy, small d, small c, I suppose, deputy convener who's a returning officer and a deputy convener who's an electoral registration officer at present. But that's under the current informal structure. So if we are constituting the board, I would like to see that continued rather than yes. Yeah. Only one of those deputies would have full powers, and that would be the returning officer deputy.
OK, thank you.
Thank you, Jackie. I'd like to move on to another area which the bill is proposing, which is about the postponement of elections. And I know all three of you representing the organisations have made submissions on this. And maybe, Andy, if I come to yours first, because I thought it was interesting in the submission about the proposal is that, in essence, the elections could be postponed by up to 16 weeks. Now, in essence, there's a policy decision there. I'm not expecting you to comment on that. But with regard to the practicalities of either a sort of double suspension or a single suspension, you know, what is the effect at, to use an old teaching phrase, at the chalk face of when that phone goes and you're told it's postponed?
Yeah, postponement, I suppose it ultimately depends on timing. When that postponement comes, if it comes really early and you're not that far down the for a better word, the project, then it's much easier to make changes and things. If you've already started, for example, engaging with your printer and have things printed in advance with dates and that on it, all of that stuff goes to waste. You then book in premises, staff for working at elections. All of that, if it changes, is bad enough. If you then change it or extend it again, then you're in essence doubling that difficulty. And if I dare use an example, the UK Parliament elections is exactly that, where it's extremely difficult to organise and plan for because it's no fixed date and it could come at any time. So a postponement, which ultimately needs to happen because obviously the circumstances that require that, just looking for an easy, make sure there's as smooth as possible transition to deal with that. And I think a double step does make that more difficult than maybe it needs to be.
So do you think that if a postponement, we put aside the cause of the postponement, would a fixed period that was set be more useful and albeit a longer period than this idea of two short periods? Would it be helpful if there was a postponement, you know, before postponement even happens, that it will be for a set period of time? Would that make the administration easier or...
I suppose it would make it easier because there would be absolute clarity of when that was, but I can see why you might need to want some flexibility in that for whatever the particular circumstances are. And I think different reasons for postponement might give a reason to extend it for different periods of time. I think it's more the sort of changing to one date and then changing again. So I suppose having a proper reflection of what the cause for the postponement was and making a judgment, ensuring it's long enough that it won't need to be extended again, I think is the point.
And would it be helpful or otherwise if the postponement, rather than just being a sort of pause for a period of time, resets the clock in a sense? So if we were 4 weeks into what's colloquially called the short campaign, and there was a postponement for a period of time that when the clock started again, it would be a 6 week short campaign or the remaining 2 week short campaign. Would that make any difference from a practical point of view from the delivery of it?
I don't think it makes any difference for the practical delivery point, because you're having to reset all these parameters anyway.
Yeah. And just before I open it up, one of the challenges that you highlighted was the recruitment of staff. Do you want to just explain why that's a challenge, given that there aren't a significant number of people who only ever do elections and then sit around on their holiday homes for the bits in between?
Yeah, no, I think most people that are employed are polling... sorry?
The convener was brave saying that.
The employing the polling staff is obviously a significant job. Most people, they do that one day, but they're doing many other things many other days. And so, therefore, it's not as easy just to say, can you come back in 2 or 3 weeks to do that? They may have already planned even holidays, so the people that are just do it once a year. Others, they'll have work commitments that they can no longer maybe keep up to. It's that change, and just being, people have made arrangements and know that date and kept that free. And staffing is a problem. Make sure you get enough staff currently. It's more difficult than it's ever been. So that change does make it difficult.
Thank you. Robert, your experience, well, not experience, but postponements, the concerns?
Yeah, from the registration side of things, registration is a year-round activity. But when you know there's an electoral event happening, that is a number of months in the planning in conjunction with returning officers. So we're currently faced with a position where we know there's going to be an electoral event in the next 10 months, we just don't know when, which makes planning complicated. So it's not something that we haven't done in the past we're incapable of. In terms of a postponement, I think we'd need to look at how that interacts with the timetable for likes of registration and such like. So that if, for example, to pick random dates, a 1st of May election was postponed to the 1st of June, during that period, there would be churn within the electoral register. There would be people who become now qualified or are unable to vote because of age, for example, during that postponement. So we just need to see how that interacts in terms of the timetable to make sure that whatever we are putting into place is in line with the law. So it's not uncomplicated, but it's not doable.
If I explore that a little bit, and if you're not in a position to advise at the moment, I'm more than happy for you to write to come back on this. Do you think the postponement should be a postponement in time, so that in essence it freezes and doesn't allow additional people to come onto the register? Or would it be better to accept that the passage of time means that there is an entitlement for people to come on and indeed go off the register, which would be, from an administrative, non-policy position, the best of those answers?
I think it is a policy position. I think there would be, well, dependent on the precise regulations, I think either would be possible, but it would depend very much within what point the timetable that happens.
If in essence we ended a period where there was going to be a 16-week suspension, let's take a longer period, but it was actually quite close to the election day, so you would have had the effect on postal votes, you'd have had the effect on registration. The 16-week period could open up, as you've described it, a churn in that. What is the... And I agree the postponement and the decision is a policy decision, but from an administrative point of view, what are the challenges between the register in effect reopening for those who are then triggered into it, or it remaining closed on the original date and the electorate being that was fixed at the point of the original intention of when the election should take place?
I think one of the problems with electoral law is it's very complex with a number of different regulations and acts following it. So I wouldn't want to give you a precise answer at this point in time. And I do suspect the answer would depend upon at which point within the timetable. However, I would prefer if the committee allow me to come back to you.
Please do. I mean, that offers a genuine offer because it is one of the things of what appears on the face of it, a useful provision to have. The unknown unknowns become very important in this. And as you say, I think you're right, whichever way it goes, it's workable. But I think there should be an input as to the practicalities of it in when those decisions are made. That's very helpful. Can I also just push on the costs element of a postponement, both from the point of view of the registration, but also on the implementation? How big an effect is the costs of it on those that administer? I don't know. Andy, do you want to?
There's a variety of costs that could come into that. Booking premises, because some premises are private, so there'll be a fee regardless if you cancel it. And then you'll have a fresh booking again, so you may be paying twice for polling places. You may have to pay for more expensive polling places, for example, because you can't get the one that you would normally use. Staffing costs, you may have already been through training and that, so you've paid for training of staff and then having to maybe follow that up again to some degree. You'll have costs for printing, so bill cards will probably have to be redone, postal packs, depending on what stage you're at with that, may have to be redone. The paperwork and that actually goes to the polling station, again, may all need to be done, depending on the timing of that. So there's all those kind of expenses as well. And that would thing. I'm trying to think if there's any more that off the top of my head.
There's always one somewhere along the line. Thank you for that. Jackie, did you want to come in on that point?
Thank you. And it's on that point as well, because of premises. I'm aware that a lot of schools are used as well. So, I think that would maybe give you another issue that you may have, because some schools close. So, how long would you need to give the education authority? You know, have you the ability to say, no, sorry, you have to close? Or is it the education authority that's willing to do so, is what I'm trying to ask, I think.
Yeah. The return officer can use the premises that's owned by the local authority. Mm-hmm. So it would be the return officer's ability to close it again, if you like. But they do, in most cases, work very closely with education to minimise disruption for obvious reasons.
Yeah, and also, if you don't mind, convener, the postal votes, if the local, if what I'm reading is correct, the local authority, local government elections could be postponed for 2 weeks. That is that has a huge impact if your postal votes has already gone out. So would you envisage that the postal votes would all be null and void and they'd have to be reissued, or would you see them, the returning one, or just the ones that have been, the ones that come back would just be used for the postponed election 2 weeks later? Because there's problems either way that we go.
Yeah, I think one of the comments, I think it was the EMB comment about the 2 weeks for local government is probably too short a period to postpone for reasons just like that. I think it then becomes into the detail of what the postponement actually means. We were talking earlier about the registration side.
Yeah.
What the actual, are you postponing it or freezing it? Are you cancelling and redoing it from scratch? In which case, as I said, the postal packs would all be scrapped. But you're right, that short period makes that very difficult, because I think holding on to them and then other people having to be issued, you can see all sorts of integrity questions that may come arise from that.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, thank you, convener. It was just to make that point on the 2 weeks. The committee will have noted that the submission from the EMB was strongly in favour of a maximum period of 4 weeks, and that is recognising, of course, that elections should only be postponed for a minimum period, but there are practical issues, particularly with an electronic count, which requires a certain type of venue, often not a school, it'll be a sports centre, there may be other bookings, there may be other... I think 2 weeks is simply too short, frankly, too short a period to make all of these arrangements, complex arrangements with contractors. Electronic counting is our contract, but it's delivered by other people, and I think 2 weeks is simply not practicable.
Short question, Stephen? Or
no, actually,
it's been answered.
That was the question I was going to ask about the e-counting. And in the submission, I think you say even 6 weeks is too short a period to reset the e-count. Is that right, Malcolm?
In our submission, we've said that 2 weeks may well be insufficient. Those are diplomatic words. I think I would say they would be insufficient, and we're saying a maximum of four. A maximum of six would be very helpful indeed, I must say. But I was working on the basis that the election should be postponed for the minimum period possible, and I think 4 weeks is the minimum period possible, but 6 weeks would, of course, allow us a little leeway.
And what are the reasons, other than cost, from your perspective, obviously, that, for example, we wouldn't be able to have by-elections in the Scottish Parliament 6 months before a general election? Are there practical reasons for that, or is it simply a matter of cost?
As a policy decision, it's simply a matter of
course.
Is the cost relative to the benefit, given there will be a fixed-term election in a fairly short period.
Right.
My last question in relation to this, again, a lot derives from policy, but your input would be helpful. Clearly, if there's a postponement being considered, there should be consultation. Are there any organisations that you feel you would like to see on that consultation list before the decision is made?
Declaring my interest, convener, obviously. I think it's right. I think for a Scottish Parliament, it's the presiding officer under the bill will consult the Commission, myself, and the returning officer, as appropriate for local government elections. I consult the Commission and Scottish ministers. I think that one could always extend consultation, given we're talking about hopefully very short periods of postponement under a statutory framework, I think that's sufficient.
Would it help if there was an explanation of the sort of grounds that would lead for a postponement? If there was a clarification of the test the presiding officer had to apply, would that be helpful from your point of view?
I think it's reasonable for all parties concerned. I mean, it's a basic principle of law that if you're exercising a power and taking a decision, you should give reasons for that decision. And I think those reasons, I think it's perfectly reasonable to request that these reasons be given and recorded.
It's helpful. Annie, can I come to you?
Yes, thank you, Convener. Good morning. I would like to talk about the electoral pilots aspect of it. And your submissions, you all seem fairly supportive of it. And I was just wondering whether there were any areas already under discussion for future pilots, or is this simply an enabling function for future pilots?
It's a little of both. I think we all recognise the practical delivery of elections changes over time. Electronic counting, of course, was the big one for local government, and that reflects positive changes, i.e. the capacity of technology to assist. It's also negative. It may in time be negative things like supply and other factors, security perhaps. So I think it's always good to try things out. I really think that's a very valuable thing to do, where it's explained fully in advance what we're doing. There's a practical point, I think, about increased accessibility. I mean, we are always trying to increase accessibility of the whole electoral process. You know, we would like to try different means of making the ballot paper available, for example. You know, you can phone a number, have it read out. I think that's a very good. Mm-hmm. I think that's a very good. That's been trialled, I think, in the north of Ireland recently. But of course, you can't test without you need the ability to suspend those elements of the rules, and that's what this provision would seek to do. And the board has asked that the board be added to the list of those able to initiate pilots. So we're very keen to do that, practically and in principle.
Thanks very much for that. And the other aspect of the electoral pilots is, do you think the consultation and reporting requirements on the electoral pilots are satisfactory?
Yes, I do.
That was an easy answer. Thank you very much. I'll take up no more of your time, gentlemen. Thank you.
Can I just pose a problem about the pilots? And if the board are added as an initiator, it might be challenging for regions to say no to the board?
I would hope not, convener. I mean, the electoral community is a close one and a supportive one, and we have a great respect for each other's views and the views of those whom we serve. So, I mean, I wouldn't anticipate any undue deference to the board in that regard. I think we would, if there was a robust argument to be made, I think it would be made, and it would be listened to.
That's very helpful. Thank you, Annie. Jackie, can I?
I would like to ask about Section 29 of the proposed bill about the Democratic Engagement Fund. I'd be keen to hear your views on, you know, the engagement fund is going to be enabling, but it doesn't actually commit funds at this time. I'd be interested in your views. Andy, you're catching my eye. I'm going to go at you first.
Yeah, I think we're all keen to see what we can do to increase engagement and both getting registered and actually turning out, which is people's free choice, of course. But I think it is an extremely difficult thing to sort of judge and sort of improve, because there are a huge number of factors, I think, that affect why people don't register, ranging from they're just not interested and don't want to maybe an accessibility issue, maybe I'm unaware, or I think we've also moved to this sort of event-driven style in the modern world, where people will leave it to the last minute or something to drive their way forward. I may be speaking out of turn, but I do think people tend to leave it to the last gasp. And if we can get them to engage earlier, then that makes the whole business much easier and prevents any issues arising when it doesn't quite happen for one reason or another. So, the fact there's no funds, I think it needs to have something against that. But it also needs to be very clear and very purposeful about what we're doing. A bit like pilots, you want them to have a clear objective and not just confuse the matter even more. And certainly make use of any funds that would be available in a most efficient way.
Yeah. Thank you. Any other?
I think a democratic engagement power is a good one. I mean, I think we all do our best and try to do our best with all areas of society, including the hard to reach groups. I think to encourage participation, we publicise what we do, we publicise how to vote. That's of course helped by the Electoral Commission and its work, but there may be hard-to-reach groups that we don't that we're not aware of, or who have needs that we're not meeting. And I think having that power is a useful one if such groups can be identified. But of course, there has to be a right just to withdraw from the political process in our culture. And the independence referendum always reminds us that, you know, where people are energised to vote and participate, the turnout can be very, very high indeed. I've had a experience of a local government election in the Western Isles where the turnout was 89%, you know, because there were particular issues and particularly strong candidates. So we can't forget that too. But I think having having that potential financial assistance for specific hard-to-reach groups, some of whom we may be unaware of, I think is helpful.
Mm-hmm. And Robert, I'm going to come to you, but I'm also going to say, I know as a former councillor that the local government there in Aberdeen, the council at Aberdeen City, their housing officers, when they were doing the new tenants agreements, part of the pack would be to encourage them to sign up, and that was through joint work with the Grampian Valuation Board and the ERO there. So, Robert, if I could come to you and ask for your views, and also, is there anything else that you think that could increase voter registration, and you know, and how best to take that forward?
That's a big question. If I can take the first part to begin with, in terms of the engagement strategies, etc. I think that within the consultation, the Electoral Commission actually summed it up pretty well, in as much as I think said that we are looking at you're highly dependent on working with partner organisations within this. With the best will in the world, a member of my team or somebody like myself going out and talking to groups to try and get the engagement is not always the most productive. Sometimes you need almost cheerleaders within the communities that are harder to reach. And many of these civil society organisations do experience funding issues. So if there was something direct which they could access, then I certainly think that would be a positive, although we do need to almost know in advance what success would look like, so that you can measure what we're getting for our the taxpayers' money out of that. So certainly I would welcome it. I think that the solution to under-registration, if that's not too much of a pejorative term, lies with the community, as much as it lies with the officials and other stakeholders. As Malcolm has just said, those of us who survived the referendum from the electoral community, it was a difficult time, but it was also empowering. It was good to see that what you were doing was valued and was engaging in the wider population. So no matter your feelings on the outcome of that, as an administrator, horrendous, difficult time, but at the end of it, you came through and you think, well, I've taking part in something that was worthwhile. And that's what we want from all electoral events, effectively, is to know that the community are valuing what you're doing and are using what you're putting in place for them. So in those terms, in terms of the potential for a fund, I absolutely welcome it. We do a lot of partnership working within the RO community with Electoral Commission and our local councils and some local groups within each of our areas. And I think that's one of the strengths of having local electoral registration officers as well. But we do need to face the fact that a lot of the community groups, whilst electoral registration is important to them, there's other aspects of people's lives that they're helping them with as well. But certainly I think funding would help raise that profile.
And do you think schools have got a part to play in this as well, encouraging our younger generation to have their say and get their names on the electoral roll?
Absolutely. We do, again, in conjunction with the Electoral Commission, look at things such as the Welcome to Your Vote Week, which runs annually within there. I think that getting registration at the forefront of young people sets it for life. You know, we want to, if you like, normalise being registered within the communities, make that part of just everyday life, that you know that you're registered. It's an important thing to you, and by doing that at that early stage, you hope that you grab hold of them, if you like, for the remainder of their life as they move through the different stages. But yes, absolutely, schools and young people's and young persons' organisations are vitally important. And I do think the likes of the Welcome to Your Vote Week is good. I would also just step back and say that it's sometimes difficult to resource all of the demands at various times, and we probably need to improve it, training the trainer, if you like, rather than necessarily us being the people that are going out and doing these things.
Okay, thank you,
Jackie. And again, I understand there is a policy to this next question I'm going to ask, but I want to talk about the practicalities. Would automatic registration cause any problems from the administration point of view of it? I know it would be a different landscape, but is there anything that concerns you about it, rather than the policy of decision about whether there should or shouldn't be automatic registration?
From an electoral registration perspective, at this point in time, I've got, if you like, two paymasters. Part of registration's devolved and part's reserved. Each parliament or government, whichever your point of view is absolutely entitled to make the decisions which they think are right for them within each of those spheres, and I wouldn't want to interfere in that in any way at all. However, it's myself and my teams who interact with the electors, and if there was divergence in this matter, I think it could have impacts on both registers. You know, the Representation of People Act says I have to have two different registers. I have to have one for the UK Parliament and one for Scottish elections. And where possible, these should be combined. So a divergence in the method and the criteria that's required to be able to be on either or both registers makes the administration harder, and I think it makes it harder for the elector to understand at the end of the day. The commonality between the two registers is certainly in excess of 90%, I think it's about 95-96%. So I think what we need to be careful with any changes which we either do via pilots or substantive changes is make sure that we don't harm the vast majority who are already registered and are already playing their part within the society. So I certainly wouldn't rule it out, but I think there's real difficulties. I can go on a wee bit more on that if you want.
That's fine. It was really from the administrative point of view that I was interested, just so we could have that on the record. And the other thing that I was just going to ask really is about one thing that seems to be omitted from the bill, which is the sort of emergency proxy vote, particularly for carers, particularly in circumstances. I don't know. If I come to you first, Andy, from the practicality point, and then to you, Malcolm, what are your views on that emergency proxy situation? Because certainly from my experience running around on election day, that's the one thing that keeps coming up and no one seems to know the answer to.
Yeah, from the practical point of view, I think, of processing the forms, then it doesn't matter. It's a policy thing about who would be entitled to and who is not.
An administrative point of view, the system as it exists at the moment is fine and could take other names added to it as to those who could apply without too much challenge.
Well, I think that was the bit I think I was hoping to. I think being able to take huge volumes does have an impact on it, because it is quite a resourceful exercise on the day. Particularly on polling day, because you've obviously got to do that. You've got to get the information across to the returning officer and so on. So there is a volume element to that, but appreciate that the policy, then you need to deal with how you resource that.
That's always election day, it happens.
Yeah, so you get one or two before, but not many.
Yeah. Malcolm, did you want to?
I have very little to add to that, other than to note there has to be a cut-off point during the day. Otherwise, it's impossible to administer.
That's very helpful. If we have finished the questions from the committee, Andy, Malcolm, Robert, can I thank you very much? As I said, the offer, once you've had an opportunity to consider if you'd like to write to us, and particularly with regard to the one matter that we've raised. The committee look forward to receiving that. But can I thank you for your attendance this morning, your contribution both beforehand in the call for evidence and this morning. So can I say thank you very much, and I will now move this meeting into private.